you now to your regularly scheduled program.
When your camera is made by Kodak, you know it's good. Tonight, I'd like to show you one of the world's great cameras.
Tonight, I'd like to show you a new idea in picture taking.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up.
I see the picture in my mind's eye, and I give it to you as the equivalent of what I saw and felt.
We choose to go to the moon.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
We will never forget that we are analog human beings.
My job is to be authentic.
We all love stories. We're born for them.
Coming to you live from Stratobox Studios in Manila, Philippines.
Hey guys, welcome back to Film Factor Podcast. My name is Francis. Tonight we are back with Born a Film on Air with fellow photographers Michael Behlen from Fresno, California, Michael Kirchoff from Los Angeles, and Basil Paulin from Manila in the Philippines. Our topic for tonight is working with analog and exploring the world of Polaroids. And of course, after that, we'll have another episode of Hashtag Masterclass. But before we begin, we would like to thank each of you for being a huge part of this passionate community. We now have 7,971 members across 81 countries, slowly climbing to 8,000. We are now on our way to our next goal, which is 10,000 members worldwide. If you're watching this and you want to be a member, just search for Photo Nation International. If you're a member and have friends or know anyone who would want to be part of it, don't hesitate to invite them over. As what we always say, everyone is welcome. Born in Film is known for organizing photography events. It's unfortunate that we won't be having any of that because of the pandemic. In the meantime, it would be advisable to stay at home and go out only if and when it's necessary. So wash your hands, wear face masks, face shields, and keep distance from the person near you. The key to fighting this pandemic is surviving. So stay healthy, and for those who are sick, fight your way through, because we have lots of things planned for the rest of the year. To our frontliners, we thank you and pray that all of you are safe. We hope that through this program, we keep you entertained, inspired, and motivated. Please do share this live video now and support your fellow analog photographers. Not too long ago, began a series of live podcasts within Photo Nation with your photography heroes. The very first one we aired on April 5, where we talked about the importance of printing with Alvin Lee. From there, we met photographers like Australian marine life photographer Darren Ju from a Tales by Light series on Netflix, and Nikola Kostic, a passionate photographer from Belgrade, Serbia. We jumped from landscape photography with Fitz Bore to the life of expat photographers with Arnold Lopostol in Singapore. We also talked about women and the things they go through as photographers with Alex Oncal, a Filipino photojournalist, Imbal Christine, a concept photographer from Israel, and Tran Hong Young, a Vietnamese nude photographer. All of these episodes can be seen on both our YouTube and Facebook page. They're also available on Spotify. Just search for Film Factor Podcast. New episodes are updated every Monday afternoon, Manila time, and early morning, Eastern, Central, Mountain, Pacific, Atlantic, Alaska, and Hawaii, U.S. time. If you miss an episode, do check them out later. We have replays every Monday. Throughout this short span, we were able to reach members of Photo Nation from different parts of the world, and the passion will live on. Tonight, we are back with Born a Film on Air, a segment within Film Factor Podcast, where we explore the life of photographers and understand their passion as we dive into the details. Let's check this out.
Portraits have always been what's interesting to me.
Art's part of photography and sharing, taking what you see and sharing with others.
don't be afraid. Get out there, shoot some film.
Photography should unite.
I think PhotoNation can be a catalyst.
Again, we are live simulcast on IGTV and YouTube. And if you're on Facebook, don't forget to follow the page, join PhotoNation, and share this live podcast. Joining us tonight are talented analog photographers from California and the Philippines. We have Michael Behlen, who is an instant film photographer and the founder of Analog Forever magazine, together with Michael Kirchoff, an analog photographer and editor-in-chief of Analog Forever magazine. And last but definitely not the least, Basil Paulin, a Filipino instant film photographer who built his own large format camera. Let that make you cue you on screen. Hi everyone, good evening or good morning. Hold on, I think you're on mute. There. Hi MK, hi MB, hi Paul, Basil. How are you guys?
Hello.
Good evening.
Hey, what's up?
Good morning. Wow. Thank you for waking up early for us.
Still waking up.
Hey, so let's probably start. The first question is, why analog, and what's with analog that gets you hooked? MB?
What gets me hooked? You know, I think with a lot of people, the hook came from feeling a lack of fulfillment from shooting digital. I think a lot of people started that way, especially people in my age group. But I think for the most part, I've always just been a hands-on guy. I like vinyl. I write letters to my grandma. I shoot film. I'd like to do a lot of things in person as opposed to over the screen. And I just think that in a society where everything is on the computer, I just like holding things in my hands. So I think the hook isn't necessarily the film part, but more the tangibility of the medium.
Great. And MK?
Why analog? Why not? I mean, I think that if you wanted to compare it to something like digital, then you would find that the analog world just has... there's more tangible, visceral aspects to it. I think it just has more soul. And I think it speaks to people on a deeper level than digital does. The more hands-on approach, I think. It just lends itself to, sharing the love, really, in terms of creating images and sharing them with other people.
Great. And Basil?
What was the question again?
The question is, why analog, and what's with analog that gets you hooked?
I like the tangibility of it. The fact that film was the first way that people were able to take pictures and document things. Like, film was made to be archival, unlike we're in digital. People usually have files that they just lose in hard drives because they hardly remember where they are. Unlike with negatives, you can store them, but still lose them.
Great. And we actually shoot analog because we want to experience it for ourselves, right? And why do you think more new photographers are leaning towards pursuing analog photography? Maybe we can begin with MK.
Why? Well, honestly, I think that the digital revolution has enhanced analog photography. I mean, it clearly had a hand in not destroying it, but creating a downturn in how people make photographs. But if you were to look at something like Instagram as a great example, when Instagram came out, most of the youth of the world kind of gravitated to it. And when they were applying filters to those photographs that they were taking, I mean, filters were really huge, especially in the beginning of Instagram. I think it's less so now. But it started with Instagram, and then all these other apps showed up that had filters. And over time, people realize that those filters are based upon using filters in an analog sense, or certainly alternative or historical processes. And as people started to discover that was the case, they wanted to experience that for themselves. So I think through online research, really, and then doing workshops and mentoring and classes, people were introduced to analog all over again. And then there are digital aspects that help support the analog world in terms of creating things like digital negatives, which you couldn't do before. So
great. And even the logo itself is inspired by from Polaroid, right?
Correct.
And since I mentioned Polaroid, we have Michael Behlen here, who's an avid instant film photographer. Michael, what do you think about that? Why do you think more new photographers are leaning towards pursuing analog photography in the digital age?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of reasons, but I know for me, and I think I've said this a few times before, but I think things are cyclical. I think, you know, every 30 years, every two decades, we kind of look back at what our parents were doing or things we grew up with, and we just want to go back to that. I think a lot of people have this aching for, you know, a simpler time, and things rarely get simpler. I also think that there's a reason why, like I said, vinyl record sales are up. I think we're increasingly getting less possessions in our house, and they're living in the cloud, which is weird because we don't actually own less. Yeah. We just can't hold it in our hands. So I think a lot of people who grew up using the cloud now, which is weird to say, they just want to look at their pictures in their hands. And I think even though they can accomplish that with digital, I think it's just a pure process. And I think people are drawn to that, just like they're drawn to old cars and typewriters. There's something, like Michael said, visceral about it. And I think it's hard to pass up once you experience it.
Yeah. Great. And Basil, why do you think, especially in your age group, more and more analog photographers are popping up everywhere?
Honestly, I think it's because it's usually like a trend or something, like I don't know what to say.
Good.
What is the question again?
Why do you think more and more younger generation of photographers are leaning towards film photography or analog?
Well, yes, I still think because it's trending and people want to go with whatever is popular at the moment. But I think some people like me, I really appreciate the process. There's this more intimate feeling when you're doing it a different way than anyone else is doing it. Like when you take a picture and then you hand it to someone, you can't exactly just do that with a digital camera.
Yeah.
Unlike when you do it with a Polaroid, it's more intimate to me, at least.
Great. And what do you think we should do to sustain this momentum? And I believe since we have the two Michaels of Analog Forever magazine here, maybe you can talk about what you need to do to sustain this analog resurgence.
Yeah, I think to sustain momentum, I think trends are, you were looking for soul in your photography or whatever the motivation for you to begin shooting analog photography or pick it back up if you haven't done it in decades. I think that's great, but I think without community, that's really hard to sustain. You know, community is what supports businesses and labs and what makes people feel good about joining something. I think all hobbies or all professions, if there's not a big community presence, I think it's a lot harder to A, begin and B, continue with that. Yeah. I think if you don't find that support. So I think with the foundation of friends, sharing, community, that's really what's going to keep analog alive. And that's one of the bigger motivations that we had for sharing analog forever. So,
yeah. And about your magazine, do you think magazines like that or podcasts like Film Factor Podcast helps in reviving the love for analog photography? MK?
I completely agree. I mean, that would be the first thing that comes to mind. Like Michael Behlen said, sustaining this and continuing on with analog processes is, it puts you in a community. It really does. And things like you said, this podcast or our magazine help to kind of keep everybody informed as to what we're working on. And the sharing aspects of social media help a lot as well. So the way things are going now, there has definitely been a resurgence, but it really did start several years ago. Probably at least 10 or so years ago. Digital took over, but I think that that takeover didn't last as long as people thought it was going to. I think a lot of people thought that that was the end of film, and clearly it's not. Now that there's a resurgence and more people have found out, especially the younger generation that are kind of really just discovering it, I don't think that there's any way for that to decrease at this point. I think more and more people are just going to find out about it. And vehicles like the magazine or this podcast are primary examples of how to keep it going.
Great. And since you mentioned your magazine, maybe do you have the magazine with you right now? Maybe we can show the viewers so that they know.
Of course. Always one in my pocket.
Wow. We really love the design. Wow. You have the first one.
Right. Number two.
Great. And
I'll just leave these up in front of my face. Just kidding.
And we actually have a more clear... there. So again, if you're watching this, both Michael Behlen and Michael Kirchoff handle Analog Forever magazine. You can go to their Instagram, Facebook, and their website. And I believe we have some photos of the magazine here. Hold on, let me. Maybe any of you can probably discuss about. What the contents are, or what they can look forward when they grab a copy of the magazine here.
Yeah, absolutely. We do features and interviews on analog and film and alternative process photographers, including bookmakers, documentary photographers, landscape, experimental, everything and anything that we think our viewers and audience will love. But I think most importantly, we love it, and that's why it makes it so easy for us to produce the magazine for you. So with that, all of our features and interviews we do, most of them are submission based. So if you wanted an opportunity to be in our magazine, or as a lot of other people have described it, a journal, it's very heavy. It's not a typical magazine. It's produced on really heavy paper and has beautiful printing, but you can have the opportunity to be a part of it by visiting our submit page at analogforevermagazine.com and just click submit.
Awesome. And MK, we were talking about this earlier. I believe you mentioned a photographer who's the cover, or whose photo is featured on the cover of the magazine. Maybe you can talk about that. Hold
on. On the edition two, the current one that's still available, we have Michael Kenna on the cover. And that right there is the opening pages of his interview. And Michael Kenna is an extremely popular and widely known landscape photographer, I guess you would, I think that that's kind of a loose term, but primarily landscape photographer. And he maintains his process of shooting with film, primarily with a Hasselblad, and then making his own prints in a wet darkroom, like we used to do, 20, 30 years ago, or actually it was really still today. I mean, it depends on who's doing it, but he has stuck by the traditional methods that he learned as a youth and continues to do it to this day. And to just call him a photographer is probably an understatement. He's also what I would call a printmaker. He does do them all by hand and all by himself. So he doesn't send them out to a lab. He doesn't send his negatives to a lab and have somebody else print them. He does them all himself. So they are the highest quality that you can possibly get in a gelatin silver print.
Yeah. And being able to experience that is really a privilege in these times, right? Because of the pandemic and everything that's going on. And being able to do it yourself helps a lot, especially in exploring more about this this medium, analog photography. And I believe we have more of the pages here. Maybe MK or MB, you can discuss more about the other pages here.
Yeah, you know, I just want to point out that, you know, our, even though the journal edition 2 has is about 154 pages, there's a lot of imagery in there, but there's a lot of words. You know, we're not just a zine that just throws a bunch of pictures page by page, throws some page numbers on there. We spend an exorbitant amount of time writing and interviewing these artists, so you can really get to know them as if you were right there in front of them. We're really proud of that. It's something that we just love doing, you know, and I would encourage you to actually pick up a copy and actually read the contents instead of just flipping through it. And that's what you want to do.
Yeah.
Please do that. We appreciate you. But at the same time, you know, I think long form journalism is dying along with the analog resurgence. And if we can bring back that with it, I think people would have a better time reading about artists and the medium we love.
Awesome. We actually have a question here from Kat Villarreal. She asks, analog photography is continuously evolving. How do you deal with purists or old school analog photographers who are not open to the analog revolution or evolution? Sorry, MK.
Well, so far we haven't. I mean, I personally have not received any kind of complaints from anybody who's a purist. In fact, I talked to a lot of people who are, and we recently had done portfolio reviews for people, and there were a couple of photographers that I spoke to. Right offhand, I can think of one in the U.S. and one that was in the U.K. that they've been doing photography for 40, 50 years, and they are definitely purists, and they've never embraced digital in any way. But they didn't. They didn't have any kind of complaints in terms of what it was that we're doing. I think that they understand that the digital marketplace has a place in analog processes. Like I mentioned before, something like creating digital negatives. Now that you're able to do that and maintain a high level of quality in doing that, you're now able to create things like platinum palladium prints or cyanotypes or albumen prints of a much larger size that you don't have to go out and use an original negative. You can create an enlarged negative now and make a bigger print that is of stunning quality. And then think that that being able to do that still speaks to people who are purists.
Yeah. And I think other than calling them purists, I think they just want to preserve right, I think they just want to preserve the medium itself and how the process works, right? And talking about what's currently happening, we have the pandemic that's going on. Has this actually stalled film photography? I believe most of the labs had to close, right? And film photographers were stuck at home. Do you think this will have a significant impact to the future of analog photography? MB?
I don't think so. I know a lot of places are struggling right now, but I think struggle is good. It causes innovation. Not that I wish that upon anybody, but I know for us, we, you know, the magazine, we dealt with some time delays, some other things, and you know, we got through it. But I think as far as labs, you know, like Underdog Labs just popped up. Sorry if I got the name wrong, in San Francisco. They're brand new. There's another lab that opened up in Southern California in the last couple of months. So I think some labs may not be open or working on limited staffing, but I think with all things, people find a way. And I think that's what analog photographers are really good at, finding a way.
Exactly.
Either they go get their own film developer kit, or they're going to scan their own negatives now. And I think whatever takes place, people who love something will find a way to make it work. So as sad as it is for businesses, I'm sorry, everybody. It's really not fun. But I think there's innovation to be had.
Yeah, and speaking about innovations and how people are trying to continue this stuff for photography, even Kodak, right? Kodak built their own apparel store with their new shirts and all of the other interesting things that can be a plan B, right? Even if it all fails. Basil, what can you say about this? Why do you think this will have the pandemic would have a significant impact to film photography in the coming years?
I can't exactly measure how significant the effects would be, but from my experience, since I couldn't get my own film developed, I thought I should probably try to develop it myself. Like what Michael said earlier, the people find a way if they do with something they love. So what I did, I made my own black and white developer, and I developed a roll that I shot, and I also did the same thing with color, although my process isn't very good yet. But I hope that we can still shoot in the future and still have film developed in labs that are more, qualified to develop film properly.
Yeah, and Basil, we have a question for you from Tristan Estepa. He asks, whose work has influenced you?
Oh, I actually take inspiration mostly from Andy Warhol. I like how his work is so... it's very vibrant and pop art-like, but I haven't been able to get that same color with the Polaroid film yet because most of the stuff I've been shooting has been expired. I want to shoot stuff that's bright and colorful, somehow just like Andy did, and maybe hopefully soon do a large screen print just like him.
Is that why you have an SX70?
Yes, I actually bought it because it's one of the cameras that Andy Warhol had, but because I just like the idea of a camera that can fold into an SLR with a really big mirror flapping up and everything. And it's just so elegant and nice that I just wanted to have it.
Great. And we actually have a question, but you guys have answered it already from Nestor Luigi Pantig. We have another one from Maria Bonaventura. She asks, question for everyone. Among the gadgets that you own, is there something that you wish you hadn't bought?
I did not buy.
Yeah, you didn't buy. You wish you hadn't bought.
I can take that one. You know, I use two Polaroid cameras. One is the Polaroid Sun 660 autofocus, which is just a one that pulls up at that. And then I use a Mint 670S. And this, sorry, Gary, but Gary owns Mint. It's difficult for me because I spent a lot of money on that camera, and my 660 is light and easy and makes it all fun. And I really only take out the Mint camera when I'm doing really serious work. If I'm going on a long backpacking trip, I usually always take the 660 now. And it's not that I wish I hadn't bought it. It's just, I think my point I'm trying to make is you don't need a really expensive camera to do good work. So,
yeah, very well said. Yeah, and MK, do you...
Well, I'm sorry, the question was...
Yeah, the question was...
Have I purchased something that I wish I hadn't? Or yes. Something that I do wish I had purchased?
You hadn't.
That I haven't purchased?
No, that you hadn't wish... the question is, among the gadgets that you own, is there something that you wish you hadn't bought?
No. No. I think, I mean, if I bought it, at this point, I will only buy something if I have a need for it. I don't buy anything simply because I covet it or I have to have it, or just because I think it's cool. I have to put it to use.
Yeah.
So when I was younger, I didn't do that. So because of that, I own like way too many cameras. And in fact, oftentimes I'll go through what I own, and I have a couple of different places where I keep things. And I recently went through one camera closet, and I discovered a couple of cameras that I had completely forgotten that I even own. And I ended up, you know, selling them on eBay because I didn't realize I bought them thinking that I was going to use them, and it just never happened. So I unloaded them, and it gives somebody else an opportunity to hopefully experience that camera and put it to use. Yeah. So if I'm not going to do it, I would rather it not just sit around collecting dust. Mm-hmm. I do kind of collect cameras, but again, it's with the intention of actually using them. So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's really important since you're spending for it so that you'll be able to use it. And Basil, what do you think about that? Have you actually bought something that you wish you hadn't bought?
Not at all. I love all of the cameras or gear that I've bought because to me it's like owning a little slice of history. I can't, like, with my SX70, I can't believe that someone else used to own it before I did. So I don't regret any of the other cameras that I've bought at all. Mm-hmm.
And we have another question for you from Tristan Estepa again. Do you have any advice for the other teenagers who want to get into film for Basil?
You can try shooting Instax. It's probably one of the cheapest things you can get at the moment other than roll film and maybe really cheap point-and-shoot camera.
Great. And the last question from our viewers, we actually are getting lots of questions now. We have one from Angelica Nicole. She asks, what can you recommend for people who would use a film camera for the first time? MB, what can you recommend for anyone?
Any camera that works. Mm. You can go to your local thrift store or if there's thrift stores wherever you guys are. You can go into your grandpa's attic. Just find a camera and shoot with it. I think it's a lot less important what camera it is and more important that you're using it. There are some great resources online where you can find them, but I highly encourage you not to spend, you know, $200, $300, $400, $500 on a 35 millimeter camera. Just use whatever, you know, Nikon, Canon A1, AE1, right? A1E. Any of those are fine. Yep. So spend the money on film.
Especially when you're just starting, right? Moving on to our next question. How do you see analog photography 10 years from now? Maybe we can get a response from MK. How do you see analog photography 10 years from now?
10 years from now? I think it's going to be more popular. But I don't know that there's going to be anything new in terms of analog processes. I mean, if you look at the history of photography, people have really kind of already worked out. I mean, there's innumerable processes out there already. So I don't think there's a need to try to kind of invent anything new. I think that there already exists so many different ways to creating a photograph now that it will just continue to sustain itself and people will, you know, especially 10 years isn't really that long. You know, it sounds like a long time, but in the history of photography, it's not very long at all. A lot can certainly happen, but in terms of the analog processes there's a reason we call them historical processes. They have existed throughout the history of photography. So 10 years is a drop in the bucket of that. So I don't know that there's going to be anything, you know, wildly changing in that amount of time.
Awesome. And Basil, you're actually active in most of the Polaroid events here in the Philippines. Yeah. What is the what are you looking forward to in terms of Polaroid? And their, I believe they just released new cameras, right?
Yes, the Polaroid now.
What are you looking forward to in terms of what they'll release later on?
I just hope that they keep making film, honestly, because or maybe they could improve the film a little more, because, or maybe even make it cheaper, because for me, it's $20 is already a lot, especially in our country. I can barely afford film. I think I've only shot like 5 packs of film, so in the future, I hope that I can still shoot it and it's a little more affordable, so it's more accessible to me.
And MB, what do you think about the what will happen 10 years from now?
Well, I think that depends on how well you and I do at creating a community that sustains people's ambitions. I think a lot of times people, or I guess the human species in general, is really goal oriented and objective oriented, even if we don't think we are. I think when we are given the opportunity to achieve something and we do that, it makes us feel really good. And I think those achievements are a lot longer lasting than just the day to day. So, you know, me, Michael, Tim, Minnie, and the whole gang at Analog Forever, you know, we're not better than anybody, but if someone wanted to say, you know, my goal is to be an Analog Forever, I think that's a great goal for them and a great compliment to us. Because that shows that we're creating something important. And just like you, if someone said, I wanted to be on the Born in Film podcast, that's my goal for this year. I think that helps Analog Photography as a whole, the person, and us as organizers. And I think we work together symbiotically. The next 10 years are going to be even better than the last.
Okay, great. Great answers from our guests. Now let's get to know more about our guests tonight. Maybe we can begin since we have we ended up with Michael Behlen. Maybe we can start with you. Hold on, let me just spin you into screen. There. Michael, what is Analog Forever magazine? Since you mentioned it, how did it start, or how did your journey begin in photography, and how did it evolve into making or building Analog Forever magazine?
Previously I ran a zine called Prime. I did that from 2014 to roughly 2018. There's different versions of that. I put out 6 issues. I did it all by myself with the help of one other person or two, Bill and Cheyenne, who edited and helped me do things, but I was doing a quarterly zine. It was a lot of work, and I got burnt out, and I took a break. In 2018, in early summer, I was having some beers with a buddy, and he basically said, hey, man, you're really bored. You should start doing something like that again. So I text Michael, and you know, I was a few beers deep. I didn't really think Michael was going to even agree, because I had previously met Michael when I featured him in Prime. That's how we got to know each other. And he said yes. So I was like, well, I guess I have to do this now. And so we did it. I know that sounds really simplistic, but I think if people realize how simple things really are, you just have to want to do it. And maybe me a lot more than other Michael. But I'm a say yes, figure it out later type of guy. So I don't really let not knowing how it's going to work or how it's going to turn out stop me from moving forward. So in 2018, we did a year of online content. We decided we wanted to start to create a community around the people that we knew and have that grow. And then we've put out our first edition of the magazine in late October, November of 2019. So that's the brief overview of how that took place.
Awesome. And how did it feel to see that first print? I believe we have a video of that. Hold on, let me share it on the screen.
Yeah, you know, we're really, really lucky to be printing with Edition One Books in Berkeley, California. It's a small business. They do amazing work, and they're frankly just great people to work with. You can put a name to the business, and they know who we are. And you know, we're a small fish in a big pond with printing. But they treat us like we are their only customer. And when they send you videos of this, just to make you feel good with your first magazine being printed, it's just, I think everyone knows how that feels, actually, because when you shoot either negatives or instant film and you get to hold your artwork in your hands, I don't think this is any different. It just happens to be a different medium. So it's exciting. It feels good. You feel proud, and you just want to say, everyone, look at this. Like, you get excited and you're just want to show the love, I guess.
Yeah. And Michael, since you shoot instant film, what's the benefit of shooting Polaroids aside from other formats like 135 or 120? What's the benefit of it?
I'm not sure there's like a benefit. I think it's all personal preference. You know, I've shot 35 in medium format. I've used some larger format cameras to shoot like pack film. Yeah. But I always keep coming back to instant film. I know I'm notorious for being an impulsive type guy. Like, I think last year I did an interview and I said, yeah, I'm giving up instant film. I'm done, right? Mm-hmm. And like 4 months later, I was like, yeah, I'm not doing that. So it's just something that I'm drawn to. Mm-hmm. I'm also a pretty hyper guy, so I'm not a big fan of waiting around mm-hmm. scanning eggs. So instant film is pretty similar to my personality. That's it, really. And it's simple. It's easy. But I think beyond the simpleness of the medium, I think there's like a rich history behind it, especially with what Florian Kapps did to bring it back for us.
Yeah.
I think just that alone is a movement I can get behind and stay behind.
Mm-hmm. Great. And you also told me that you were part of the Polaroid Expo. And was that in Spain?
Yeah, that was actually an experimental photography festival. That was last year. I was with there with about 150 other people with Pablo and Laura, who put that on in Barcelona. It was a really good time. I did speak on two panels, one of them being analog photography and social media, and the other one about publishing in some form. And it was a really good time. It was like a summer camp for analog film.
Great.
Photographers.
Yeah. How does it feel, especially that... 2018 was it actually the time where what was the year that Florian Kapps actually rebuilt Polaroid Originals? Was that in
14?
Yeah. How does it feel to see lots of instant film shooters all in one place?
Yeah, so it was instant film, experimental film, double exposures. There's all type of photographers there, but I did get to meet a lot of people that I've known on the internet for 5 or 6 years. Mm-hmm. And so this sounds bizarre, but like we're friends, right? Like it's we've never met in person, but I think the instant film community is really close knit online, so accepting of everybody that I got so many hugs from people that I've never met in person, but it felt like I've known them forever. And yeah, it's like going to summer camp and like going back year after year and you don't see these people except during the summer. And when you do, it's like you just pick right back where you left off. And to have that sense of community makes you feel loved. And I think that's something everyone needs. And that's something the instant film community is really good at giving each other.
And something to look forward to every year, right? And speaking of your photos, we have have some of your works here again. Hold on, let me just cue it on screen. Hold on, here. So again, for our viewers, you can follow Michael. It's at Michael Behlen on Instagram. His Facebook is facebook.com/MichaelBehlen, and you can check out his website. It's don'tshakeitlikeapolaroid.com. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. It's a communist contention. Don't shake it. You're going to ruin your emulsion.
Okay, so let's move to your first photo. Maybe you can talk about this photo.
Yeah, that's in Mineral King, California, in John Muir or Ansel Adams Wilderness, one of those. That's it. Yeah, that's at the end of a hike of a long day, actually. And I was like, if you see the water at the bottom of the photo, my feet are soaking wet and I'm tired and I'm really hungry. And but I saw the reflection of the blues and had to capture it.
Mm-mm. Beautiful. And okay, your next one.
That's on the same trip, but actually a few hours beforehand. No, I'll take that back. That's in the Red Mountain Basin, about 20 miles from any person or road. Yeah, that's it. I'm a simple guy. I like shooting landscape. I don't have a big artistic statement for you. I'm sorry.
I love the colors actually here. Good hues. And I believe there's a difference in terms of temperature when you shoot instant film, right? That's actually one of the problems we've been having here since we're a tropical country. The humidity actually affects instant film here. So
are they yellow or oranger or redder or magenta?
I believe they're they're more magenta-ish and yellowish. There are times that they're bluish. So it depends on the temperature, I believe.
You know, I've also found altitude. Like when I'm really high in the mountains, like 9,000-10,000 feet, I feel like my pictures are even bluer. And it's probably because it's cooler up there. But even when I've shot pictures at the same temperature in lower elevation, they're a little less blue. And maybe just the production date of the film. But you could tell this is in the morning, right? It's pretty blue. I think living in California, I've been pretty lucky that a lot of my photos don't have that magenta shift. And I'm also, I'm not sure if the film is heated during transport when it goes to other countries from the factory. And maybe being in the United States, I'm a little bit more fortunate with that film being taken care of on its, on its way to me.
Michael, have you tried the new production of the instant film from the new Polaroid? Have you tried them? Are they good?
What do you mean?
The new production of the film. I believe they improved the color. Is that true?
I'm not sure. So I'm the one of the weird ones. I don't actually pay attention to the production. I just don't care that much. I think it's, I'm a detailed person when it comes to important things like running the magazine, but when it comes to my personal life, I really try not to obsess about stuff like that. So like these are all production from the beta film they put out before they rebranded. So I really like that color batch, but honestly, I just, whatever's on Amazon will get here the next day because I'm always last minute buying film. That's the production date I use. So
great. And we have more of your photos. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's a hell for sure lake. That was at the very end of a backpacking trip. And it really made my day getting that photo. I forgot that in California, we have these things called bear cans. And in order to eat your food and bring your food, you have to carry it in this container, right? But it's locked, so a bear can't open it. Unfortunately, when you hike from like 0 feet where I live to 10,000 feet and you don't open it to let the air expands and you can't open your bear canister due to pressurization. So I was very, very hungry, and I was throwing this bear can off like big boulders and rocks and trying to smash it open to eat my food, and I was starving. And I'm not dead. You know, I was able to open it, right? So that's not really the point of the story. The point of the story is that my camera's what I took a break from that, and I shot some photos, and this is one of them. And oh man, it changed my attitude.
And the,
when
and
I
the,
got it, I was like, this is the one. And yeah.
And the textures actually add to the photo itself, right? The white thing, it actually adds a bit of a story. Here, Michael, your next photo.
Yeah. This is towards the end of that same hike, and this is in Mineral King, and this is a photo I almost didn't take. I think everyone knows the Polaroids. How do you call it? Exposure latitude isn't fantastic. So I was really debating whether or not I even wanted to take this photo and quote waste film, right? Because you only have so much when you're carrying just a backpack. But I did, and I'm really fortunate. It's not a photo I would usually take, actually. But I'm really happy I did. So take chances, people. It pays off.
We have a response from Sandra Weber. She says, love that photo.
Thanks, Mom.
That's your mom.
Thanks, Mom. I love you, Mom. Everyone, if you don't have a mom like that, you better go talk to her.
Okay. Your next photo? Go ahead.
This is in Yosemite. Yeah, I like this photo for a lot of reasons, actually. It was like 34 degrees. This is on New Year's Day, like a couple years ago. And it was cool going to Yosemite during that time, especially in the winter, because there's no people, right? So I think being a spoiled Californian, you know, I say I don't like to go to Yosemite because there's too many people there ruining nature, which is true to an extent, but they need to experience it too. And summer is just the most popular time. So if you see that, you know, I went there in the winter, obviously it was very cold, which is why it's not as contrasty or punchy when you shoot in the cold. But I like it. I don't think it's a typical picture of Yosemite Falls.
Looks great.
And yeah, that's just why I like it. You wouldn't really know it was that either. So I think I was able to take a place that everyone knows and make it just a little bit more mysterious.
Nice. And your next one? Wow.
Yeah, so my favorite time to shoot is right after the rain. We don't get a lot of it here in California, despite what maybe other people think. But when it does rain, there's a couple places I really like to go. One of those places is the river. This is about 30 minutes away from my home. So in the next morning after it rains, I'm usually really excited to get in the car and go on a hike and go see how the fog or the rain and the clouds are going to look. So, yeah, that was a really good morning. Really cold morning, actually. And my hands were really cold. But it was worth it.
The viewers actually love your photos. And your mom says you're welcome. Next. Here. Go ahead.
Yeah, this is in Morro Bay, California. It's the tides coming in and out. Those tide rivers, I guess we'll call them, are only accessible an hour or two a day. Depends when the tide comes in and out. And me not being a scientist, right? I have no idea when they're actually going to come in and out. I'm sure I could look it up somewhere, but I used to drive by there for work. And one day it was sunrise, and it just happened to be perfect. And you can see where I grabbed the photo and put it in my back pocket on the way to work. And that's where that comes from. But I think it's just makes it better. You know, I think without that imperfection, the photo wouldn't have the charm it does now.
Exactly. And your next one? Go ahead. Wow.
Yeah, this is in San Francisco, actually. I forget the beach name, but my sister lives there. And one of my favorite things to do is go to the beach when it's cloudy and moody when no one else is there. I think you guys are getting a pretty consistent feel of where I like to go, and it's usually where there's no people. But yeah, it was a good morning, and I remember running out. My sister was about two blocks from the beach, and I remember seeing the clouds, and I was like, I gotta go, and I was like wearing sweats, and I looked like a hot mess. But I ran to the beach about two blocks away to take that photo. I took a lot of photos that morning, but this is the one that I chose to share.
Awesome. And your next one.
Same. I lied. This is the other one. Same day, right? It's weird how different pictures look when you just turn 90 degrees the other direction, right?
Yeah.
So to the left, you know, I caught the sun reflection, and this one is pretty neutral.
It somehow looks minimalist.
Yeah. I am a self-proclaimed minimalist, I guess. I think a lot of my photos center around symmetry and calmness and stillness. My last two books I put out were called Searching for Stillness. And hopefully when people pick it up, they find a little bit themselves.
Great. And your last one.
Yeah, that's in Point Reyes, California, which is a national park, I believe, about an hour above San Francisco. I think if anyone wants to go drive up and down the Highway 1, I would highly recommend visiting there. It's just a tranquil place. It's not something that's really been touched by us, thank God. you know, we pretty much ruin all the nature we come in contact with. That's what we do good as humans. But I was the only footsteps for like 2 miles. And also, it was in the winter. It was in March. So highly recommend going to nature when in March, when no one else is there. You'll get a tranquil, almost spiritual experience.
People are actually loving your photos. And some of them are actually now following you on Instagram. they're commenting. Michael, we have some of your behind the scenes here with us. Hold on, maybe you can talk about this. I believe this is your launching, right? Is it your launching for?
Yeah. So we threw a big launch party back in November for edition one. We did it at SF Camera Work. Thank you, everybody who helped with that. We got to have artists come. We sold some magazines, and we just had a party and a celebration. It was wonderful. I actually got to meet our staff for the first time in person. We met all online through with Michael's help with Tim and Minnie Ann. That was great. And the next morning, we had a photo walk. We walked from the Glasskey photo, thank you guys, to the Leica Gallery and to SF Camera Work. And it was just a wonderful morning of just being jolly.
Yeah.
It was a really good morning. That's it. Yeah, it was great. And I'm right there with my thumbs up. That's
With your thumbs up. Nice. And we have here your camera. Maybe you can talk about how different it is from the ordinary SX70. Here we go.
Yeah, so that's a Mint 670S that I used a lot. I know I said previously in the episode that I was saying I regret buying it, and I don't think it's so much that I regret buying it, and it's well worth the money. But I often find that, unlike Michael, who has a couple years on me and a lot more maturity, I impulsively buy cameras that I don't need at all. So that's what I do. But this camera is something I've held on to. I've actually bought and sold them multiple times. Every time I'm shooting, I'm like, oh, I want this, right? So I need this camera. And then I don't use it as much as I think I will, and I sell it, and back and forth. So I guess learn from me, just hold on to your cameras, guys. Don't buy and sell them all the time. You just, but I think with this camera, I like it because I can set exposure, and I actually use my phone as an exposure meter. So I'm able to meter exactly what I want and shoot instead of relying on the little wheel. On the regular SX70. So highly recommend it. It allows you to do long exposures. It allows you to shoot both SX70 film and regular 600 film without the change of an ND filter or anything like that. I love it. And Gary's a genius for putting this camera together. And you should all go support him at Mint Camera.
Great. And we have a comment here from Janjan Kapili. He says, love the dreamy, nostalgic feel of those Polaroids.
Thank you. And with that, I hope they look like good memories too.
Hold on. And on that note, thank you, Michael, for sharing your story. Please stay. Let's say goodbye together with the other guys. Again, thank you, Michael, for sharing your story and your photos with us.
You're welcome.
Great. And let's now welcome back MK, or Michael Kirchoff, who is the editor-in-chief of Analog Forever magazine and the founder of Catalyst Interviews. Is that right? Among other things. Hold on, let me pin you on screen. Hold on.
Yeah, pin me.
There you go. MK, how's it going? Thanks. Hold on.
Good.
How has the pandemic affected your pursuing analog photography? Has it affected it?
Well, I guess it has restricted my ability to go out and travel like I would normally do. I mean, I can certainly do some travel local, and I have a little bit, you know, on some hikes and some drives to go to some places more local to take photographs, but I've been using my time, my pandemic time, my coronacation. I've been using it to actually kind of get ahead on all of these other projects that I have other than my work, like Analog Forever or Catalyst Interviews. And then I also started another column through 112 Publishing called Traverse that's about photographers who reside and create work outside of the United States. So there's, you know, I do my own commercial work, I do my own fine artwork, and then I kind of have these three outlets for examining and sharing the work of other people, other photographers. So that's become a, you know, just as big a part of my artistic process as creating photos.
Awesome. And since you mentioned the magazine, you're also the AIC of the magazine. What sets Analog Forever magazine from the other magazines available today?
That's a great question. I think when the original idea came about for the magazine, which obviously came from Michael Behlen, and that hallowed phone call that he made from a bar to me, which incidentally, when he said that he asked me to do it, if I hadn't have said yes, he probably wouldn't have done it. My initial thought when he asked me was to say no, because I was already busy working on my own photographs, and I was up to my neck in beginning work on Catalyst interviews. Mm. So I really didn't think that I had the time. And so when he asked me, in my mind, I was shouting, no, don't do it. And then I just said, let's do that. That's what a great idea. We should take this and run with it and make it something really special. So the exact opposite of what I was thinking, because kind of like Michael, I can be a little bit impulsive at first, in terms of when people ask me to participate. Collaboration is a big part of my life, and when he asked me to do something like that, my initial thought and impression was, let's do it. Even though in my mind it was probably, I think it was at the time, was against my best interests, which was wrong. I was completely wrong in thinking that, because it's been a really great experience. And in terms of making the magazine, I'm getting to the point of the part where you said how we're different or what sets us apart. You'll see the original intention in our Instagram handle. It's Analog Forever Zine. And I think that the original idea was that we were just kind of going to create something more or less informal and, kind of do it yourself and create something, just a zine, like something small, not a lot of pages, not really slickly produced. And just about making analog photographs that we really liked and responded to from other people. And that quickly kind of morphed into, it became an online presence initially to build a following. So it was that way for a year. And during that year, the idea of the physical magazine quickly changed to kind of like a regular magazine, like you might see on a newsstand. And then once production started, we realized that, our thought process continued to change and evolve, and it became more pages, more slickly produced, and a soft matte cover, which is really beautiful. And it's now more or less kind of a journal or a soft cover book. So we've had a couple of questions about why do you even refer to it as a magazine? Because it seems to be something more than that, which is great. I'm glad that people think that it's something more. And that is part of what sets it apart from other magazines that are like us, which there aren't really a whole lot, at least not that we know of in the U.S. I mean, there probably are some other ones that around the world that we're just not even familiar with, but we didn't make it with the intention of seeing what other people had done, or getting ideas from them. We just did it the way we wanted it to look. And a large part of that comes from the fact that it's not just Michael and I, it's a team effort. Michael and I, started it together, but we quickly realized in order to reduce burnout, we needed help from other people. So we enlisted the help of Ninian Kelly, who's in Northern California, and Tim Scott, who's in the suburbs of Los Angeles here. And then later, after the first issue came out, one of the artists from the first issue, Lynn Birnbaum, she has become our social media and community manager, and she's been a godsend, because the social media, as you know, really kind of takes a life of its own. And that's like a full-time job in itself. So the five of us now are the people behind the magazine. And Tim Scott is he's the one who's done the layout and the design. He designed the logo. So his expertise has been tantamount to everything that we do. So in setting us apart, we kind of sit at a place where people who are just getting into photography in a serious manner, like you might call them serious amateurs, those people who are serious about it and want to kind of progress into making a serious body of work and be what some might refer to as an emerging photographer, mm-hmm. and then into like a mid-career photographer as the years go by, mm-hmm. we want to kind of bridge that gap for people. So we show the work of people who haven't been around a long time, and we show people like Michael Kenna, for instance, who've been around a very long time, to kind of show that transition or the, you know, the steps that it takes to get from point A to point B like that. So
great. And it sounds like a very tremendous work, and we appreciate what you do, and we hope to see the magazine here in Asia. I believe you actually partnered with Japan Camera Hunter, right?
They did a review, they did a review, came out 2 weeks ago, right at the beginning of the month. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it was really great. It was great. We sent the magazine to a few people to review it or just kind of get opinions. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't really outwardly ask for formal reviews. They're great, and the best reviews actually come from the fans and the people who love the magazine and who have purchased it with their hard-earned dollars. Those are the people that we really appreciate. But there's obviously significant value in getting somebody like Japan Camera Hunter to review the magazine, because it helps with our you know, just visibility. In order to keep going, we have to sell the magazine. So, this is more or less a passion project. You know, none of us are getting rich off of this at all. And if you measure the value of our time versus what we've received financially, we haven't really received anything financially. So we've gotten paid literally nothing to do this. In terms of, I don't know, feeding our souls and doing something that we can really get behind and are passionate about, it's kind of a way of giving back to all the other photographers who are working really hard at what they do. So we get a lot out of it in terms of that. Great. And it's that way with the other projects that I do as well.
Nice. And for those who are watching, we'll announce later where you can get the magazine, so that you won't forget. We'll talk about that in a bit. And Michael, since you're also an analog photographer, and we love your works, they're very outstanding. You shoot with different analog mediums, right? What do you love about the process?
Well, everything, really. When I started, there was no digital, right? I've been around a long time. I've been doing this. I've been a professional photographer for 30 years. And personal projects have always, and personal, you know, photographs have always kind of had been a part of that. But it was really 15 years ago, I'd say, that I really kind of started to be serious about it and kind of market myself as a fine art photographer as well. And I did that because I really wanted to, apply the art of what I do to the commercial side of what I work on, and be known for that, because I would rather people hire me for my vision than anything else, rather than just kind of take photographs that they want me to take. Like the magazine or any of my other projects, it should be a collaboration. Right? It should be a meeting of the minds, and you should be able to work out a best case scenario for any project that you do. So being able to collaborate with like-minded people is a really important part of that process. And analog, doing that in an analog way, it just seems a little bit easier. There's certainly digital aspects to everything that I do, but the love of analog, it's always been there with me, and it just hasn't changed. So, like they say, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So I use cameras, you know, what people refer to now as vintage cameras. For me, when I started, they were just cameras. There was nothing vintage about them. So, I don't know, it's just something that I love.
Great. And speaking of your photos, hold on, let me pull them up on screen again. For those who are watching, don't forget to follow Michael. His Instagram is at Michael Kirchoff, and his Facebook is facebook.com/Kirchoff photo, and his website is michaelkirchoff.com. So, okay, so with that, let's dive into your photos, Michael.
All right. Do you want to know about each of these or just the process
up
or
to
both?
You. Go ahead. Maybe where it was shot or what you love about the photo. Go ahead.
This was shot in Tallinn, Estonia. It's a monument. I believe it was called Marjame War Memorial. Mm-hmm. It's part of a body of work that I have called An Enduring Grace. It was a 10-year project that I started in 2007. Mm-hmm. And it was my exploration of the cultural landscape of Russia. Mm-hmm. And in doing so, I also traveled to not just Russia, but to former Soviet republics, of which Estonia was one of. So you will find influence in the landscape, especially the architecture of a lot of these other countries from the Russian people. Or the Soviet people at the time. Mm-hmm. So this was a Soviet-built monument. It was a World War II monument, mm-hmm. Which many of the monuments in Russia and in other countries that were built by Russia, mm-hmm. They were all, a lot of them are to World War II, because Russia lost more people during World War II than any other country by far. Mm-hmm. So it's still something that's very fresh on their minds. Mm-hmm. And you'll see it pop up over and over again throughout history and throughout the landscape. And this is a very, what they call brutalist architecture, mm-hmm. that a lot of the Russian, mm-hmm. especially the Soviet era Russia, is known for.
Great. And your next one? Go ahead.
Well, this is kind of what a lot of people will think of in terms of Russia. It's Red Square. This is called Road to Red Square. And I had basically laid my camera on the cobblestone street that led into Red Square. So on the left, you'll see in the distance, the outer wall and the mm-hmm. towers of the Kremlin. And on the right, you'll see St. Basil's Cathedral, mm-hmm. which both very different styles of architecture. So in one place, you'll kind of, it's really a great place to kind of get a historical perspective mm-hmm. of what has happened in Russia.
Amazing. And the next one in Paris.
This is actually not a Polaroid. I do two things. I do the Polaroid work and I do other film work, primarily shooting either Kodak Tri-X or Ilford XP2 film, although I don't really shoot that anymore. It's basically just Tri-X now. And these are all photographs that were made with a Holga toy camera. Mm-hmm.
Great. And
that's obviously Paris. So.
Yeah. The Redwood.
This is from the only body of work that I'm currently working on with Polaroid, with the vintage, not vintage, with the original Polaroid that I love so much. Mm-hmm. So this was actually made in 2000, 20 years ago, in the Redwood Forest in Northern California. Mm-hmm. At the time, this was the tallest redwood tree in existence. Ooh. And I had hiked there to get this photograph. And one of the most difficult things to do is to photograph an entire redwood tree because as soon as you take a couple of steps back, all of the other trees obscure it. So the only way to kind of really see one is up close and personal, right at the base, looking straight up. So thankfully my style and my process lends itself to being able to capture something like this. And oddly enough, I had discovered probably about 6 months after this photograph was taken, the tree was struck by lightning and it destroyed, I can't remember, I think it was about 50 or 60 feet of the top of the tree, and it went from being the tallest redwood to the third tallest redwood with one lightning strike. So, you know, what's nice about doing photographs like this is there's a preservation of time that takes place. And I like being able to kind of hold that in these photographs.
Wonderful. And the next one?
This is also from that same body of work. I don't think I mentioned the name. It's called Sanctuary. And it's, I guess, in a single line, I would say it's my love letter to Mother Nature. Hiking, camping, being in nature, that's kind of my, you know, that's my sanctuary. That's where I go to in terms of kind of getting away from it all. The stress of life can weigh heavy on people at times, and I think just taking a simple walk out into nature will kind of cure a lot of what ails you. So that's where these photographs, that's where the intention for making them came from.
Great. And your next one, I believe this is in China.
This is, yeah, this is the Great Wall of China. One, obviously, small section of it. But I had been in China for a photo festival. And when the festival was over, I took some time of my own to go out and make photographs. And this was simply one that that I made along the way. It's a small, I don't even consider it a body of work. I kind of consider the work that I do in two ways. There are projects which are more well-rounded, thought-out bodies of work that are created with intention. And then there are smaller collections. I refer to them as collections of work that are, you know, anywhere from 10 to 20 images that are created, you know, kind of on the fly in shorter periods of time. And that's what this this was. There was two trips to China that I had made, and this was one of the photographs during the first trip.
Nice. And the people are actually loving it. The next one?
We're good. This is from one of my favorite places to visit, one of my favorite cities on Earth. This is in Prague in the Czech Republic. Prague is a living, breathing time capsule.
Yes.
It is so well preserved as a European, an Eastern European city. During the two world wars that the planet went through, especially the Second World War, Prague was used by Nazi Germany as more or less a base of operations.
Yeah.
So, you know, you're not going to bomb the city that is your base of operations. So all of the bombing that took place happened in other cities around Europe. And Prague was largely preserved because of that. A lot of, you know, I think if you were to go to into any other major city in Europe and talk to a historical scholar, they would talk to you about a lot of the places that simply don't exist anymore because they were bombed out of existence. And that just didn't take place in Prague. And this is was photographed just outside the, basically at the time, this was the front gate to Prague Castle, which sits atop of a hill. And then you would walk in, and one of the first things that you would see was St. Vitus's Cathedral, which is a Gothic cathedral within the compound of the castle itself. So, and that's one of the guards that stands guard outside of
the gate
castle.
Yeah, I love the. There's actually an analog camera store there. Were you able to go there?
Yeah, I did. Well, there's actually, I think there's a couple now. Yeah, I did. I went, and I can't even remember what it's called now. But I did. Yeah, I wanted to go there, and I think that they dealt primarily in Polaroid and instant film
and Russian cameras.
Yeah. Oh, well, actually, one of them is called Polagraph, and I did not. I wasn't able to visit that one. There was another smaller one that I went to. It was a little, really kind of a hole in the wall place. But I just kind of came across it by accident. And I had actually been there a couple of times now. But yeah, Polygraph actually has a small gallery space as well, which is nice. So if I get back there, that'll be a place I visit.
Great. And your next one?
This was in Spain, in Caceres, Spain. I was in Spain for work. And oftentimes when I go for commercial work or when I'm working with other photographers, I will take my own cameras with me and make photographs in any of my spare time. I don't let any time get wasted when I'm on a trip like that. If I'm not working for the reasons that I'm there for, if there's any spare moments, spare time, it could, you know, 10 minutes to the entire day, I will take all of that time to search and explore and look to make photographs. I mean, I love traveling and I love exploring. So this was made during one of those trips to Spain.
Great.
And this is part of a collection. Same thing. There were a couple of trips to Spain that I had done 1 year that collection was made out of.
Love it. And the next one?
This is a slightly larger project. This is an examination of the above-ground cemeteries in and around New Orleans, Louisiana. It was just something that I was fascinated with. And then at this particular time, there was kind of, this one's titled Heavenly Light. And it was just kind of one of those moments where you realize that kind of the clouds literally opened up and the sunlight shone through. And, you know, there's some lens flare there. There's the dramatic clouds and it all was just kind of one of those moments that kind of came together. I was actually photographing in the other direction. And like a lot of people will tell you when you're out photographing, always look behind you. So I did that and this is what I saw. So I spun around and made this photograph.
Great. And let's now go over your behind the scenes. I believe you sent us one of your behind the scenes photos. I know you don't take lots of behind the scenes photos. Maybe you can talk about this one.
Yeah. In fact, is this the only one? It might be the only one. This was myself, my wonderful girlfriend, Wendy, took this photograph of me when I was in the Alabama Hills in California, which is an area adjacent to a town called Lone Pine. And honestly, actually, if you were to fly over those mountains, you would land at Michael's house. He's literally on the other side of that mountain range. So California has an incredibly diverse landscape and a lot of very unique places. And the Alabama Hills is one of them. So I was there with friends, actually just having a good time. But I was there also to take photographs, which I often do. You know, I take my cameras most everywhere I go. And I don't know. I was just there taking photographs, and that it was. There was a photograph that's in the sanctuary collection that was taken from that very spot that I didn't send you, unfortunately. But
awesome, Michael. Do you have any top three tips that you can share with our viewers about film photography or what you do?
Top three tips. Well, I guess I said one of them already, always be looking behind you. I would always be looking up as well. You know, it's easy to focus in, you know, if you see something that you like and you intend to make a photograph of, definitely do that. But also think about whether, you know, other ways to show it, change your angle, you know, lower your angle, raise your angle. One of the things that I really love in terms of making photographs is if there's any kind of apparent weather happening. You know, if you can see weather in a photograph, so I always believe that that will improve the scene. If it, and that means if it's snowing, if it's raining, like some of Michael Behlen's photographs along the coast, you know, although those waves crashing, you know, that creates an atmosphere, it creates a feeling. And I think being able to see that in a photograph can greatly improve any image.
Great.
And I guess one other tip would be to experiment. One of those questions earlier was, what do you suggest for somebody just getting into analog for analog photography? Mm-hmm. And I would, then that's really, it's just experiment. Look at what you like, ask how it was made, and then, you know, kind of maybe experiment by trying that process. And I don't mean, you know, copy it or plagiarize somebody else's work, but if there's something specific that you like about someone's work, explore that. And you use different cameras. You're gonna go through a lot of different styles and methods that don't work for you. But over time, you will develop a way of seeing and a vision for yourself that people will recognize. You know, mm-hmm. we can show my photographs or Basil's photographs or Michael Behlen's photographs, mm-hmm. and as you look at them, you'll be able to recognize a certain aesthetic that lies in all of those photographs. And if somebody can walk into a room of photographs and see one of yours and say, that belongs to Michael Kirchoff, then that's a huge success.
Yeah.
So, but it takes a long time to get there.
Yeah. Really good tips from Michael. Let's now go over your cameras. You've actually sent, hold on. You actually sent us some of your cameras. Here you go. Go ahead.
I think there's something that unique happening with the photographs that I make that it didn't used to be so unique. Mm-hmm. Because, like I said, this was something that was kind of ordinary and average way back when. Mm-hmm. So the fact that the film that I used isn't made anymore, and it's all expired, and I'm having a very difficult time finding it. And the fact that I've been using what we now call vintage cameras, that lends itself to the process end of what I'm doing to help give it that unique look. I like to use wide-angle lenses. I like things to be very cinematic. Mm-hmm. So this camera is called the Graflex XL, and this was a next generation to the Graflex Crown Graphic and Speed Graphic cameras that were 4x5. Mm-hmm. So this is a modular medium format camera. So it has interchangeable lenses, interchangeable backs, interchangeable grips, and in some cases, interchangeable viewfinders. This one is outfitted with a 58 millimeter lens, which in 35 millimeter terms is kind of equivalent to probably around somewhere between a 22 and a 24 millimeter lens. And this outfitted with a Polaroid back. I do own and can use film backs for it as well, mm-hmm. different formats. Mm-hmm. They're all 120, but I have a 6x6. A 6x9, and I think I have a 6x8 back as well.
Wow.
For shooting 120 format film. But again, that Polaroid back basically lives on there. And then there's a red filter sitting there because more often than not, when I'm out, when I'm in an exterior location photographing with it, I'll often use a red filter.
Especially when you shoot black and white.
So, yeah, and that's all black and white. It's all black and white Polaroid. Mm-mm. Positive, negative Polaroid.
Mm. Awesome.
Which I can go over awesome. As well.
Great. And your next camera.
So this is a completely different camera, but very similar in terms of how it operates. It's a Brooks VeriWide, as you can see by the name. It uses the same Graflock system for attaching film backs to it as the Graflex does. So that it's a different Polaroid back, but those are interchangeable. So I can put the same film backs or Polaroid backs on this camera as I can the Graflex. So that makes things a lot easier. It has a wide angle viewfinder at the top. The Graflex was a rangefinder. This is a zone focusing camera. So you kind of have to, you know, guesstimate the distance that you are from your subject and dial that in on the lens. And then that I often use with a yellow filter. It's a much slower lens. That's a 47mm lens, so it's even wider than the Graflex. And it's smaller. So I used to only take the Graflex along with me, and now I often will take the Brooks with me simply because it's a little bit smaller and easier to use. So when I'm traveling, it makes it a little bit easier. But because the lens is slower, and the film that I use is very slow, it gives me a little bit more exposure to only use the yellow filter as opposed to the red, which eats up a lot more light.
Awesome. And on that note, thank you, MK, for sharing your story. We love your cameras and how you do your process. We hope to read more on the Analog Forever magazine. See you later. We'll say goodbye together. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. And again, finally, last but definitely not least, we have Basil Paulin, a college student who likes to experiment on his photography and built his own large format camera. Okay, hold on. Let me pin Basil. Hey, what's up?
Hello.
What's up? How's it going? Now that you're currently doing school, right?
Yeah.
How's it going? How has the pandemic affected you? I mean, in terms of photography, are you still...
I'm not able to shoot as often because of the inaccessibility of the film. I can order online, but I can't exactly shoot outside as often as I'd like. And since there is a pandemic, my mom doesn't give me money for... buying film. So I still had a little bit of leftover money before the pandemic started, so I bought a few rolls of film with those and one pack of Polaroid film. I was able to shoot them with my friends, and it's also what I used to test the first black and white film that I've shot, and I developed it. So far that's all I've been able to do.
Awesome. Basil, you actually created your own large format camera. Can you tell us how it works and why you built one? I believe we have a photo of that. Go ahead. Go ahead, explain. Tell your story.
Well, I was just watching a bunch of YouTube videos, and then I saw that there's these videos with really gigantic cameras, and as soon as I watched one of the videos, I just really wanted to own one and try to use it. So I spent a month or two creating and designing the camera. It's not fully functional yet because there's still some parts that I need to buy and things that I need to fix. The focusing system here is incredibly janky. I have to wing it most of the time. Even the ground glass at the back is made of a thin layer of glue and a panel of glass. It's a little hard to operate, but when it does work, sometimes it looks really good.
Great. And why did you build one?
I just really wanted to try shooting large format negatives or anything, honestly, because I also looked around online for how accessible large format film can be for me. It's not that accessible, so yeah. I just opted to buy those really cheap, what are they called?
120 film?
Paper negatives from Film Folk. They sell 5x7 ones for, I think, $5.50 for 20 sheets. I bought 3 packs of those and just started experimenting.
Yeah, and that's true. I buy my large format film from B&H or from Hong Kong. And it's really hard, especially when you like to venture out into large format photography here in our place. Basil, you shoot Polaroids primarily.
Yes.
And We love how you're very creative with it. What's the best thing about shooting Polaroids?
Most of the things that I like about shooting Polaroids is the magic that it's kind of there, even though it's actually science, but it feels like magic because you just watch the image come to life. But my favorite thing about shooting is that in the past, a lot of other people have different methods on how they can kind of manipulate the film, kind of like a more analog Photoshop. It's more hands-on. Mm-hmm. So I really wanted to try experimenting with a lot of those because unlike an Instax, I think you can barely even do a transparency with it. Unlike with Polaroid, it's really simple, but a little hard if you're not well practiced.
Great. Since let's now dive into your photos. Hold on, let me pull them up on screen. Hold on. Again, for those who are watching, you can catch Basil on his Instagram. It's at herbivore52, and his Facebook is facebook.com/basil.paulin. Okay, and your first photo. Go ahead.
Oh, this one was one of the test photos. This is actually right after I got my SX70, I think like a month or two after. Mm-hmm. I bought from someone in the Facebook Marketplace 3 packs of really expired, what's it called? Impossible Project film. But when I tried those out, none of them came out. The pods were completely dry. Mm-hmm. So with this film, with this shot, I actually bought film from Polaroid Originals in Greenbelt for 400. They were on a sale for expired film. This is actually the duochrome film. It's black and pink, but you can see it's not even pink anymore. It's just like a regular black and white photo. This was just a test shot, but I kind of like how it came out. There's some bands on the side because I was too excited that I forgot to clean my rollers.
Ah. Okay. And your next one, I believe this is you, right?
Yes, this is me. I just wanted to try to, I don't know, I just wanted to take something with glass because I like how the way, I like playing around with light in a sense because that's, I mean, I like taking photos. It's technically capturing light. I wanted to see what it would look like if I took a photo of me, if I focus on the glass and not on me. So you can see the cracks are really, are kind of sharp and I'm out of focus. I just really like how this came out.
Great. Very, very artistic. And your next one.
Oh, this one is same from the first pack of film I've ever shot with the camera. You can still see the bands on the side. This was, I think, around Halloween-ish last year, 2019. Me and my friends just were walking around in our costumes, and then I brought my camera with me, and he just looked kind of good, and the background was kind of nice, so I wanted to take a picture. And that's basically it. I like how it turned out, though, even though it's not black and pink. I kind of like how more it's more monochromatic than black and pink.
It is, yeah. And your next one.
This one was a double exposure of the same time, the same film pack. I just wanted to try the double exposure thing with these, because when you have an extra Polaroid cartridge, you can cut off the metal thing, the spring, and you can prevent it from ejecting the film off of the camera. So in essence, you can take as multiple exposures as you want, and I just wanted to experiment with this.
Great. And your next one.
Oh, this is of my friend Tristan. I was testing out the camera I bought also. It's a Polaroid automatic 350, the really big folding bellows camera. It's a really expired film. I think this one was expired 2005. And I'm just surprised that there were still chemicals in it.
Great. And your next one. I believe this is your first try at developing, right?
Yes, that's my friend Luigi. This is what I was saying earlier. I bought a few rolls of film that I could afford. This is Shanghai GP3, I think, is a 100 ISO black and white film. I developed it in Caffeinol. I just wanted to test out if Caffeinol would actually work for developing black and white roll film instead of paper negatives, which I usually developed instead of rolls.
Your friends.
I like how the actually there's the little cut area there that's an accidental double exposure because the advancement system in my Shanghai camera is a little off. I think I'm going to have it fixed soon when I can. Mm.
Your friends are actually commenting. I believe they are the ones on the photo. We have Luigi
and
Tristan watching. Okay, and next one.
Oh, that's my friend Tristan still. It's just another test shot. We were sitting in his garage. It just rained after, so it was a little gloomy. It was hard to kind of focus, especially with the waist level finder on the Shanghai. Mm-hmm. I'm still glad that how this turned out because of how black the shadows are. Mm-hmm. And that I'm just amazed that I was still able to develop this film and actually come up with a negative with it.
Mm. Next.
That's my friend's grandfather. I just wanted to see how the film would look like on his wrinkles, but with the focusing distance on the Shanghai camera isn't that close, so I couldn't get close enough to see his wrinkles. But I'm still glad of with how atmospheric the photo looks.
Okay. And your next one. Go ahead.
Oh, this one was for a school project, actually. That's my friend Max. I shot this on a Polaroid Color Pack 3. I found it in my brother's old room. But weird thing is I didn't find any other photos that had their old Polaroid peel apart film like in any of our albums. So I was wondering why we even had this camera. Mm. And I still had like a leftover pack of Fuji FP100C. So I decided to go to shoot it. Mm-hmm. This one had this film pack had less chemicals in it, but this last one was one of the ones that had more chemicals in it, but it came out really blurry and grainy, but I still like how it looks.
Yeah, looks great. And your next one. This one was
actually fairly recent. It is when I still had a pack of film from the Polaroid Originals workshop in BGC. I still had two shots left. Yeah. I still had two shots left in my camera, so I thought I'd do something with it.
Did you win?
I wanted to try doing the emulsion lift. This is my first try. I'd like to think that it came out pretty well. I did it on paper.
You're actually one of the winners, right? From our workshop.
I don't remember.
Yeah, because you have the film.
Okay,
and I'm not sure. The behind the scenes that you sent us is your camera. And with that, thank you, Basil, for sharing your story. We love your photos, and we hope to see more of what you share. And with that, let's bring back our guests. Hold on. Let's bring them back. So again, we have Michael Kirchoff, Michael Behlen, and Basil Paulin. Just for a wrap up question, hold on. Just for a wrap up question, I have one last question for all of you. Your final thoughts. Why do people need to shoot with analog or at least try it for once? Maybe we can begin with MB. Go ahead. I think you're muted. Sorry.
Sorry about that. I think it's like offering people drugs. It's an addiction. The first one's free, right? So, trust me, if you get into analog photography, you'll never have a problem staying away from anything else in your life because you won't have the money to do so. But joking aside, if you want to experience what it feels like to. For me, I don't want to say anyone else, but for me, I feel like I'm my true self and I'm making my art that I want to make when I have an analog camera in my hands. And I think a lot of people can relate to that. There's something tangible and mechanical. And when you hit the shutter button on the camera, you don't hear this weird fake digital click that you hear at weddings when people don't know how to turn it off. But there's something about a human making a camera that can only be operated by you and being in full control of the process, especially all mechanical cameras that are no batteries at all. I just think there's something special about it that if you've never experienced it before, it'd be like, well, why would you go to Six Flags and go on a roller coaster? That sounds silly, but once you do it, that's time of your life. And I think we all have the time of our lives every time we pick up an analog camera.
Great. So. Yeah. And maybe how it's really organic, right? And how it's not digital or virtual like what we see with digital. Basil, your final thoughts. Why do people need to shoot with analog or at least try?
Well, I think if people are primarily shooting digitally, I feel like if they switch to analog, it's a nice way to slow down because in digital, you can, let's say you have maybe a really big SD card, you can just take shots and then pick the ones that you'd like later. Mm-hmm. You don't even have to think about your photos. But with film or any analog format, you have to slow down, really think about your shot and composition because if you run out of film, then you're not really in a place to take photos. And but for me, I guess also I'm really more into the process because it's more hands-on and intimate, unlike in digital, because it's not like it's like software. It's different. It feels more, it's better, things feel better when you can touch them, to me at least.
Great. And MK, go ahead.
I think that probably the best reason for most people is because it's fun. I mean, it's an enjoyable process. I think it gets you out, gets you away from a computer screen, and a monitor. The digital, you're going to spend more time with digital in front of a computer. And in analog, you're not. You're going to be outside. You're going to be maybe in a dark room. You know, there's so many different processes that you're never going to become bored with it. I mean, digital is, you know, it allows you to do anything that you want to do in terms of making your photograph look the way you want it to look. But if you can do that in a more hands-on way with the analog process, you're probably going to enjoy yourself a little bit more and have a good time. You know, if a good way to look at it is if digital was a horse, analog is a zebra. So you're gonna get more out of it. There's gonna be a little bit more visual interest.
Yeah.
I think. And as fast as digital is, you know, especially shooting Polaroids, as any of the three of us can tell you, that's the original, you know, instant gratification that you would get in terms of making an image. Now it's digital, but you kind of have to make it something after the fact. Whereas with a Polaroid, especially, you get like it comes out of the camera looking the way that you intend it to look. And it's, I mean, there's no better feeling, I think.
Great. So. Great. Really good answer. We have actually have a follow-up question for the both of you, for MB and MK. Regarding Analog Forever magazine, how long does it take for you guys to gather enough content to be able to release a zine? And how do people contribute? I believe Michael mentioned it earlier. Maybe you can mention it again, how they can contribute to your...
Yeah, of course. I'll answer the first question about how long it takes. I say it takes us 90 days to go from... We have a submission. I guess I should start with question number two, now that I'm doing it that way.
Go ahead.
So there's three different ways that someone can contribute to the magazine. One, you could tag your photos on Instagram, Analog Forever, easiest way. We're constantly going through those. Two, we do have a Facebook group, Analog Forever group, that they're more than welcome to join and share their photos. We're constantly looking on that group as well. And the third thing is to respond to our calls for entry. And within that, we do have two different types. We do a biannual call for entry for the print magazine. We will be doing the call for entry for issue number 4 sooner rather than later. But we have a cycle, right? So that leads me into It takes about 90 days, 120 days. So we do submissions. We review submissions as a team. We propose articles to each other. We then do interviews with each artist, write the articles, goes to editing. Then we go to design, and then proofing, printing, and then shipping. And as we've just released edition two, edition three is right around the corner, and we're starting to go into a pretty cyclical editorial calendar. Yeah. What we do, which I think is a little bit different from other people, is that we actually respond to every single email that we get. I'm sorry if it takes me longer than a week or two. This is a passion project, but I promise you will get a response. A lot of the submissions we get for print or online, we do save them, the ones that we feel are worth saving. I'd say we save a good percentage of those, and we actually respond to everyone and say, you know, this is in our respiratory for later. So don't lose hope, and please follow up with us. So I think we do that better than other publications. I think sometimes when you make a submission and no one ever gets back to you, it just makes you feel sad. I think it's just acknowledging that we've received it and just encourage you to keep shooting analog is something we do really well. So please contribute. Our next call for entries for that will be going up in the next few months. But in the meantime, we do a monthly online group exhibition. Wow. We get a curator, an esteemed curator from around the world, and we have them propose a theme, and you get to have your work seen by a high-profile curator. Wow. That is every single month, and usually the third Monday of every month, we post an online group exhibition. Yeah. So even if you don't make it into a feature or an interview, you still have the opportunity to be a part of our growing community by doing that. Sure. This month's online exhibition is created actually by our editor, Tim Scott. It's called Simple Complexity, the Strength of a Photograph. And this is actually the first time we're going to do an interactive online group exhibition. I won't go into all the details, but I can tell you it's going to be a lot of fun. Yeah. So if you go to analogforevermagazine.com and click on the submit button right on the top of your screen, it's going to be the first thing that pops up in the first thumbnail. Click on that and make sure you submit your photos or your friends' photos. We want you to be involved. This is why we're doing this.
Great. And please do share it on Photo Nation so that we get the people to join your group as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Great. And since we mentioned the magazine, MK, maybe we can, maybe you can share how the viewers can grab a copy of the magazine.
Well, the primary way is through the website. If you go to analogforevermagazine.com, right at the top, there's a link that will lead you to be able to purchase the magazine. We have several stockists who are carrying the physical print issue in their stores. There are various places around the world that are stocking it. So if you want to avoid shipping charges, which can get exorbitant at times, then visit one of those stores. That is also, that list and those places are also on the website. So the primary place for everyone to go to learn about everything that you need to know about the magazine is on the website. That will lead you to everything from submissions to features and interviews, online exhibitions, and it'll point you in the direction of all of our social media. And like Michael said, we have a Facebook page and we have a Facebook group. Those are both destinations to become a part of our community, just the way you do.
Great. And yeah, for those who are watching, please do join Analog Forever, their group, so that we get to share the love for film photography. And speaking of how to grab the magazine, we're actually doing a promo, right, Michael? MB? Hold on. Let me pull it up on the screen. Hold on. Let me put you back. Let me pin you back. And then maybe you can discuss about the promo that you're sharing with us. Go ahead.
Yeah, so for all the listeners of Film Factor Podcast, we do have a special offer for you folks. We're offering just a dollar off any of your orders. You can do that up until October 15th. So if you didn't catch this live, that's okay. We just want to say thank you for listening to us talk about our magazine, our our personal artistic lives and getting to know us more. It's the least we can do. Like Michael said earlier in the podcast, we cut costs pretty close to what it costs to actually produce the magazine. So I promise you $1 off is a stellar deal. So if you can do that, and it is, the code is Film Factor, all caps, all lowercase, doesn't matter. You can plug it in at checkout and it'll automatically provide that discount to you.
Awesome. Thanks, Michael. Again, we'd like to thank our guests for sharing their story and joining us tonight and sharing their time with us tonight. Again, we'd like to thank Michael Behlen, Michael Kirchoff, and Basil Paulin from the Philippines. Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And again, don't forget to hit subscribe on our YouTube channel, and this will also be on Spotify. Just search for Film Factor Podcast. Again, don't forget to join Analog Forever, their group, and don't forget to like their page and check out their website. Again, thank you everyone for joining us. This has been Born in Film on Air. My name is Franz, and thank you for joining us. Please stick around. We have the masterclass next, where we'll talk more about visual storytelling and creative composition. Thank you. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Portraits have always been quite interesting to me.
Art, part of photography, and sharing. Taking what you see and sharing it with others.
Don't be afraid. Get out there, shoot some film.
Photography should unite.
I think what the nation can be a catalyst.